Here's what I know about parenting. Every parent knows that a child, what their children's needs are. And so it's not about giving Audrey Kale what everyone else has. It is identifying what the needs are of an Audrey Kale community and parent body and matching those resources to that. That's question, that's the answer one day. So I do think, I absolutely believe that. Here's something I kind of want to throw out. You know, poverty to us looks a certain way, but I would challenge us to begin to think about what I would term the new poverty.
I can't see poverty.
Right. Well, I think what we're seeing is that there are parents in the southern end, in the northern end of the district, who are very well-to-do on the outside, right? They, you know, perhaps have had tremendous change in their households by way of people losing their jobs, and so they're now, for the first time, having to figure out how to access a system they've never had exposure to, how to get help. Their children are sensing that, and it actually shows up differently in a classroom. All teachers can identify something's weird going on with this child. And if you peel it back, you will see that what they really need is some kind of attention, psychologically or emotionally. So this role will actually make sure that we're giving those resources to Audrey Kale. And I actually think that that would be something that parents are open to and that the principals are open to. You asked the other question about reinventing the wheel. You are absolutely right. We have had all kinds of iterations of family engagement. Parent University was a way to do it, but that is one tool. And it is one tool that I think worked well initially, but I think we've got to look at delivering access to that level of courses and helping to empower parents in different ways. As a parent myself, I'm looking for the book and the instruction guide to how to do it well. And I will take help wherever I can get it, but we've got to do a good job of even marketing to myself, right? Multiple kids, full-time working mom, when do I have time to go to a class if I'm doing everything else? So how am I actually looking at how we give Parent University access in different ways for all parents? So yes, we have done it in the past. I think it can be vamped up again. I don't want you to see this as a bureaucratic, an additional level to bureaucracy. I think what we absolutely need is accountability for it, or we'll find ourselves here again. So I need someone to hold us accountable, and the superintendent's holding me accountable for, what did you do? How do we know that it works, right? So we don't repeat ourselves again. And it is about building relationships. Now, what's the budget? We're in budget season or approaching budget season now. It's a creative department. So other than the grant money from Parent University, that's pretty much it. So we are in the process of coming up with what that could look like in terms of an ask for local dollars.
I'm in that department. Let me just say something to you. Our department, prior to her taking it over, we had like 6-7 people. I have 47 schools. And the way it's done now, Parent University is a part where I'm out mostly every night. I am not effective. So we need to look at a change, because I can't do what I need to do to help 47 schools. If anything, our budget was $1,200.
Okay.
So anyway, that we need a budget.
I've actually had a meeting with Johnson C. Smith. As you know, they received a huge grant, and one of the things they're looking at is research into parent engagement. And so from that research, it will tell us, specific to the Northwest Corridor, exactly what the barriers are to family engagement, what the opportunities are. So we're working with them to see if we can't leverage that and have some learning about what it would take to redefine what parent engagement is. One of the interesting questions that we've had is the difference between parent involvement and parent engagement. So my grandmother had an 8th grade education, and her whole thing was, get your lesson out. You come home, get your lesson out. There was no checking of the homework, going to the school, so was she engaged or was she involved? So really, we're really coming to a point where we're gonna have to define what it looks like, because it looks very different than it did years ago. So Catherine Block actually is the new Chief Communications Officer. She worked in the Auxiliary Services Department and is in the role of Chief Communications Officer now. In terms of the Comer curriculum, I remember it, but I would need to pull it out again and kind of brush up on that?
Not all of it, but look at some of that.
So I think one of the things that's important, and we talk about this every week in our staff meeting, is how are we and when are we engaging you all? So you got to start with a plan. So now what we do is when we talk to principals, we're saying, okay, what are all of your needs? And when do you need them, right? So that we resist the temptation to wait to the last minute to say, oh my goodness, immunizations come up the same time every year, I promise they do. So how are we ahead of that ball so that we can have the conversation with all of our partners that say, okay, this is traditionally a gap for us in this community. Who are the partners at the table that can fill that gap? If it is providing the service, at no cost, or if it is, we need to have those costs covered. Now we can have that conversation in a strategic way because we can begin earlier in the process with identifying the need. So, because I hear that a lot from partners, business partners specifically, they call me because they want teacher appreciation lunch. Teacher appreciation is always in the month of May, right? So how do we map that out and really begin to think about it differently so that we can engage partners differently? And it's not feeling like, you know, I've got to do it. I don't have a lot of time to plan. There are several models across this country. He came from Montgomery County and also Washoe, Nevada. And so there are models that are successful, but I want to make sure that we are tempering. I want us to look at models, but I also know that Charlotte is very, very different. It is different in that we have a very active community, a very engaged community across the board, a very active philanthropic community. So there are things that we can take best practices from other places, but I will tell you that I am excited about the opportunity to create what is successful for us here in Charlotte. We have 88,000 registered volunteers. 88,000. If we don't get another volunteer, that should be plenty to help our students. So it's not about volume. Roz, I think one of the strategies that I am going to use is it is all about how receptive the principals are. And quite honestly, to start this, I only want to work with those principals who are open to receiving help and understanding what help looks like, and actually using that as a model to show those principals who are probably a little harder to bring along, right, because their focuses may be different. So it's all of this can't happen at one time. So the idea would be that we phase it in. But as you phase it in, you're actually phasing it in so that they're talking about how it works well and what kinds of things they need to bring to bear in order for it to work well. I totally know that that's one of the challenges, not just for volunteers, but for all partners, right? When people come into a school, it is all about how welcome you feel, if it's a parent, if it's a partner, if it's a volunteer. So really working with our principals and identifying principals in this first go-round that are open, that are willing and able to do that is, I think, key. Yes, actually. So there are two pieces to that. One of the last things that Beatrice did was we created the foundation. So the foundation right now is little, and there's a task force, one of 22 task forces, that is looking into what that foundation could look like. So right now that is a part of the department, but who knows as a result of the feedback and the work of the task force where that could end up. Mm-hmm. So that's one piece. In terms of that whole community partnerships, the school makes program, all of that is in this department.
Okay.
Okay, I have to answer that. I have integrated that.
Ma'am?
40 years ago.
Is it that now?
I think one of the things that I would, if I could, just push a little bit to talk about the fact that when we think about community, we need to think about all of the children as our children. And that's very important. if you're a parent, you know that every child is different. You know, you got two, you got three, they're all very, very different. But if you have an umbrella of support, if you have a network, an ecosystem that supports all children, then we're looking at supporting children no matter what they look like, no matter where they live, no matter what their needs are. And that's what I'm thinking that we need to look at differently as we move forward 2013 and beyond. How can we create the opportunities for all children to see different types of people who care about them, who love them, who respect them, who have a conversation and relationship with them, and let that transcend the specific need of any one individual group? Now, do I think we have specific needs? Absolutely. And so that's another reason why I absolutely think that we, as a broader community, need to step up to the plate and meet all of those needs. But I would challenge us to look at all of the children and their needs and a way for us to wrap our arms around all of them.
So all of them, do you need, emphasizing Black students need? Can we have a Black male academy in the community? You say all, but it seems to be
well, and I think one of the things that, I don't know if you're aware, but the superintendent right now has tasked, he has appointed 22 task forces, and one of those 22 is looking at African-American males. So he's brought different people from the community together, and they're asking those tough questions. What do they need? Why are they disenfranchised? A whole host of things. Now, out of that work, I am confident that in that room, there will be something that we can lift up as a community to see what those needs are. So I don't want to prescriptively say today what that is, because there is a process in place, and there's a committee that's looking at that. Specifically around African-American males. So many people volunteer to go with their child on a field trip. That's the same, they're in the same system. So there's the person who doesn't have any children, maybe one of the seniors in our community who has a reading buddy. That's all included in that number. So you have varying levels of involvement and engagement. My point is with that number, is that many of them are engaged, many of them are not, right? So in terms of vastness, you can't do it all at one time, and that's not my approach at all. It really is to phase it in. And so what we're trying to figure out, we're in that process of figuring out what is the number? How much would it cost for us to come up with a plan? What is scalable in this first phase 1 year? Is it 10 schools? Is it identifying schools in a feeder pattern? And how do we engage community around that? So we're in that process. Another one of the task forces is the Family Engagement Task Force. So all of this will help inform the creation of an approach, because it may be in this room that they say they have a brilliant idea that we've not thought about how to approach that. So in terms of numbers, if we look at it as the whole thing, that is a bit daunting. But for me, it was always and will always be a phase-in process, right? So if you can manage a smaller amount and do that well, then you can bring other folks on. We have a tendency, I think, in the district, history has shown us that we take it all and we just jump in and do it big, right? And whether it's effective or not, we do it big. So really, one of the learnings that I've had is that it's not about how wide we do it, but how deep, how effective can it be? And that means you've got to make it smaller.
The involvement part and the engagement part of the students, can you address that?
Yes, so what is the engagement and involvement part of the students? What role do the students play in this? I think it is really important that they help us define, right, through the needs assessment, what their needs are, right? Have we asked students, we haven't typically asked them, okay, how are you feeling? What is it that you would want? What kind of interaction would you like to have? And that will inform a part of that needs assessment about each school.